technology. Yet we are faced with fundamental issues which have stifled economic growth in the region for more than a decade. Whilst we recognize that this discussion on growth and development is aged, we are cognizant of the danger of imperfect information. The more knowledge we acquire, the better equipped we become to address the challenges faced. We are therefore grateful for the opportunity to learn from our distinguished guest lecturer. I am Jovan Lewis, an undergraduate student in the BSc Economic Program. On behalf of my course lecturer, Dr. Anki Scott Joseph, and my classmates, we are pleased that you have chosen to be here with us this morning. I now invite Dr. Scott Joseph to give a few brief welcome remarks. Thank you.
Good morning. Students, ladies and gentlemen. One of the most exciting things about teaching economics, it's an area in which I am very, very excited about. I am very passionate about it as well. So this morning, I am honored that my students have this opportunity to draw from this unique experience to learn from Dr. Honohan, who is also very passionate about sharing his experience in economic development and other issues relating to economics. Now, I want to address my students at this time. Before I do so, Dr. Honohan, again, welcome to the University of the West Indies, and the Department of Economics is grateful that you have accepted this invitation a second time. As we say in the Caribbean, when you're nice, you do it twice. We're really happy that you have chosen to be with us this morning. To my fellow students, my colleagues, I want you to see this opportunity not as a time to simply enjoy today's guest lecture, but I want you to see it as an occasion where you are able to enhance your views. Opportunities like this, guest lectures, discussions, are utilized to help stimulate your intellectual curiosity. And so I want to encourage you to try to find forums like this where you have the opportunity to enhance your knowledge so that you would be better able to perform as an economist. In addition to that, I want to say that I want to first and foremost acknowledge Ramon. Please stand. This young man, I call him something similar to storm chasers. I call him econ discussion chasers. Him and his colleagues, they are everywhere I look. Any economic discussion, guest lectures, they are always asking, Mom, where is it? We want to be there. And I want you to emulate him. Try and find forums where you can actually learn. And Ramon, I want to just publicly say, continue to be a motivated economist. Welcome, and thanks for being here. To the rest of the audience, I want to say welcome to this event, which is co-facilitated by the Central Bank of Barbados. We are very happy that you have allowed us to draw from the knowledge of Dr. Honohan. And I want to say at the end of it, I'm sure we will all emerge with a richer knowledge. And I trust that this new perspective we'll have on economic growth and public sector involvement would be one that would lead our thoughts in new direction. At this time, I am saying welcome to all of you again. Please enjoy, and I'm going to invite Ian, my distinguished student, Ian Constantine, to introduce our distinguished guest speaker. Thank you.
Thank you for the warm welcome, Dr. Scott. Good morning, protocol having already been established. Dr. Patrick Honohan joined the Peterson Institute for International Economics in March 2016 as a non-resident senior fellow. Dr. Honohan was a governor of the Central Bank of Ireland and a member of the Governing Council of the European Central Bank from September 2009 to November 2015. Prior to this, he served as professor of International Financial Economics and Development at Trinity College Dublin, where he is an honorary professor of economics. Prior to this, he spent 12 years on the staff of the World Bank as a senior advisor on financial sector issues. During the 1990s, Dr. Honohan was a research professor at Ireland's Economic and Social Research Institute. In the 1980s, he was economic advisor to the Irish Prime Minister, Garret Fitzgerald. He spent earlier spells at the Central Bank of Ireland and the International Monetary Fund. Dr. Honohan is a graduate of University College Dublin and later received an MSc and PhD in economics from London School of Economics in 1978. He was also a lecturer at the London School of Economics and taught at University College Dublin and as a visitor to the University of California, San Diego. In addition to this, he served as a lecturer at Australian National University as well as Trinity College Dublin. He was elected a member of the Royal Irish Academy in 2002. In recent years, Honohan's research was focused on monetary and financial sector policy. His work on financial issues include evaluation of how different policy approaches have affected the overall cost of these crises in both developing countries and advanced economies. He has also studied exchange rate regimes and their choices, along with access to how low-income households receive financial services. He is the co-author of Systemic Financial Crises, Finance for Growth, Finance for All, and Financial Liberalization, How Far, How Fast. Dr. Patrick Honohan has also published extensively on the Irish economy. He recently focused on the Irish banking crisis of 2008 to 2012 and the economic performance of Ireland in the euro area. His previous work on Ireland analyzed the earlier fiscal crisis of the 1980s and performance of the European monetary system, the role of multinational corporation profits, and the interaction of unemployment along with migration. Fellow students, invited guests, ladies and gentlemen, please join me in welcoming Dr. Patrick Honohan to the podium.
Thank you very much, Ian, for that very nice introduction. Delighted to be here. Second opportunity to talk to University of the West Indies about, in this case, growth. Last time I talked, 10 days ago, I was talking to postgraduates mainly about issues of over-indebtedness. I want to get largely away from those detailed financial issues to talk about the long sweep of growth and the role of government in growth. I think you find a tension between people who think that government is the entity that must be the main driver of growth and other people who think that government is gets in the way of growth. I think the, as is often the case in these kinds of dichotomies, the truth lies somewhere between those. And I want to illustrate that. I think the most useful way to illustrate that is to get to a concrete example. Theory can take us so far. Cross-country comparisons is another useful way of approaching this kind of a problem. But I want to share with you my understanding of one particular case, and you'll guess what case that is. Last year, 2016, was the 50th anniversary of the independence of Barbados. It was also the 100th anniversary of the Easter Rebellion, which led to the independence of Ireland. So Ireland has had almost 100 years of independence. The independence actually came five and a bit years later. So I want to talk a little bit about Ireland's growth history, which is a long span of 100 years. In fact, I'll go before the 100 years and tell you what happened before independence a little bit, and try and draw some lessons about the role of government, both positive and negative, in generating the Irish growth experience. Overall, taking the 100-year horizon, Ireland's growth experience has been broadly a success. Obviously, you can find shortcomings, but it's been broadly a success. But it hasn't always been a success. I think it's instructive because it illustrates how trying to manage a small economy in a world where buffeted by wars, global recessions, technological changes, can be managed, sometimes with success and sometimes with failure. But I think it's also, I think, a very important example for countries that achieved their independence in the late 1950s, early 1960s, 1970s, who are about a half a century into independence, especially because after a half century of independence, Ireland's experience had not been good. And it was only in the second 50 years that things started to come right. Barbados is also a success story, but many countries who achieved their independence in the 1960s have had a rocky time. And I think it's useful for countries that are dissatisfied with their experience of their first 50 years of independence to realize that the second 50 years can be a lot better. The message I'd like to take from this analysis of what went wrong and what went right is that it's easier to make macroeconomic errors, easier for government to make macroeconomic errors, and possibly more important for government to make the correct microeconomic decisions, decisions about microeconomic policy. Before independence, Ireland had had a very bad time. Let me just show you one indicator of how bad, and that is the population of Ireland. This is actually the population of the whole of the island of Ireland, and as you know, part of it is part of the United Kingdom now, but we take the whole island there. And you can see from the graph, it runs from 1820. This one runs up to 1870, so it's a 50-year period there. And everything seems to be going strongly in the first part of that 50 years. The population is growing steadily from just over 7 million to just over 8 million. Then there's the famous potato famine, followed by long period of, well, first of all, lots of deaths in the famine, but also long period of emigration. And the population of the island of Ireland fell to 5.5 million by around 1870. It continued to fall after that. It's now back up to about 6 million. So if you want to see failure, there's failure there, because economic policy, social policy, was not able to cope with the shocks that had occurred. And population collapse, I think, is the most dramatic evidence of failure. Okay, zoom forward into, and I won't say anything more about the 19th century, but zoom forward to the 20th century, and let's look also at population as a broad omnibus indicator of how well is the country doing. And here I have the two greenish lines, the upper line, just to continue the island of Ireland, but let's look at the Republic of Ireland, the part that became independent, the lower green line. You can see the population, which is measured on the right-hand scale, it was still around the 7 million that's in 1840s. I forgot that this is drawn from 1840s. It's drawn from the 1840s. You can see the population still falling, and by independence here, I don't have a pointer, but it's around there. It's still falling and doesn't show an increase until 1961. So the first half century of Irish independence is a period of declining population, economic stagnation. You might say, well, you know, those are difficult times. There was post-World War I. There's the 1930s, Great Depression. There's a Second World War. There's a lot of bad things happening out there. So, you know, give Ireland a bit of credit for surviving, at least only a small population fall in that period. No, look at the population of all 17 small European countries for which I can find the data, and start here around somewhere in the First World War. Well, they're doing fine in terms of population, so they're able to support a rapidly growing population. So something is going wrong in Ireland in the first half century. There are all sorts of peculiar things happening in Irish society, reflecting the strange things that are reflecting the malaise of the economy. There again, dramatically, from 1841 to 2002, Ireland, falling population, and all these other countries that you can imagine, rapidly rising population growth. There's the Netherlands. Population growth 450% in the period 1841 to 2002. So here's a... If we're talking about population, population has... the growth of population has various elements, including migration, including including fertility, including marriage. And here's an example of how extreme Irish demographic patterns were around the middle of the 20th century, around 1950. I say around because the dates are slightly different for the different countries. And here we have a whole lot of countries which for which data was collected for a government report in the mid-1950s. And so all the countries for which data was available, you can see the marriage rate is higher in every one of those countries, a lot higher than in Ireland. So the countries have not been selected to have very high marriage rates. They've been selected because the data is available. Ireland has the lowest. Here's the percentage of males who are unmarried in their 40s in Ireland, again around mid-century. In Poland, only 5% unmarried. In Spain, 10% unmarried by the mid-40s. But in Ireland, 30-something percent. Strange age at marriage. Again, high ages at marriage. 28, the average age at marriage for those people who did marry. And on the other hand, they do get married, lots of children. So very, very, this is a strange characteristic of Ireland, which as economists we have to examine, say, are these economic factors? Maybe there are other factors that are totally uneconomic, but I like to put that up as an example of things were not going well in Ireland in the middle of the century, 50 years, 40 years, 30 years after independence. Well, you often heard talk, if you ever paid any attention to Irish economic developments, you often heard the expression, the Celtic tiger. This was used in the 1990s. It was the Asian tigers were rapidly growing economies, Korea, Thailand, Taiwan, Hong Kong, the Asian tigers. They were roaring and leaping ahead. And Ireland started to grow very rapidly in the 1990s, so commentators referred to Ireland as the Celtic tiger. But I think the tiger is the wrong... First of all, there are no tigers in Ireland, except maybe in the zoo. But there are hares and rabbits. The Irish hare is a very common, distinctive creature in Ireland and not known in other parts of the world. You probably know the story, Aesop's fable of the hare and the tortoise. And the tortoise... Tortoises here, turtles here, and they walk along very slowly. And if they want to get somewhere, eventually they get there. He started at the beginning of the lecture, he was over there, and he come around across here, and he's still going along. But eventually he gets to the other side where the piece of lettuce is. The hare rushes ahead and then gets distracted or goes to sleep, gets interrupted. So I always say the Irish growth experience has been like the hare, the Irish hare, rapid spurts of growth punctuated by interruptions and economic setbacks. And I think this lesson, sort of what I'm going to illustrate, shows positive and negative roles for government. The positive roles are when what government did allowed the economy to rush forward like the hare. There were good microeconomic policies put in place which supported strong economic growth. But there were negatives by government on several occasions when the government tried to overreach by pushing hard on a macroeconomic growth pedal and led to crisis. The healthy growth happened when the country embraced the openness to the rest of the world, created policies that were going to allow Irish people to benefit strongly from interacting with the global market. For example, ensuring adequate education, health care, and having a social safety net, because being exposed to the global economy means that factories can suddenly close down. There can be adverse shocks. The global economy is a risky place for a small economy. The crises happened when there was overborrowing, when there was a loss of competitiveness of the economy, when there were unrealistic interest rate policies set, and when those policies came home to roost. Also, when there was inadequate regulation or over-liberalization of banking. So let me start with the micro policies and just list a few of them. Of course, we could be here all morning identifying blow by blow all the different measures that government needs to put in place for a healthy economy to function effectively. There are two periods of strong growth, strong and steady and sustainable growth in Ireland in the last half century. One was centered around the 1960s, and the key elements there were the opening up of the Irish economy to international competition, the emphasis on education and on social services. The second period was the 1990s, the so-called Celtic Tiger period. And there, the role of taxation policy and wage policy was important. So the elements I've selected out for the first period: openness to foreign direct investment, membership of the European Community, tax incentives and grants for foreign direct investment, free secondary education, and an extension of the social safety net. We don't have time to run through all of those, but just very briefly, foreign direct investment. Before that, before the 1950s, the government had decided that they really wanted to retain Irish ownership of Irish business. So if a foreign company wanted to get involved in Ireland, they generally had to form of a joint venture with an Irish company. There were great limitations on the degree to which a foreign company could come in, just set up an establishment and operate under its own rules and with its own full control. And there were tariff barriers, considerable tariff barriers, including vis-a-vis Britain. In the late 1950s, there was a sharp policy change, a decision to open up to the rest of the world, to, instead of preventing foreign enterprises from setting up autonomously and forcing them to have a majority Irish partner, they were actually encouraged to come in with special grants. Government industrial promotion agency set up to go out and find companies that might be suited to the Irish conditions. Tariff reductions, an agreement with the United Kingdom to create a free trade area, which of course presented risks for existing Irish companies, but bigger opportunities for new Irish companies and for the existing companies that could improve their efficiency and adapt to the much larger British market that would be open to them. Eventually, that became part of a larger effort to join the European Community, which also involved free trade, not just with Britain, but with the rest of what's now called the European Union. But I also want to emphasize free secondary education. And let's see, I think that's what happens next. Oops. No, I wanted to show you some illustration here of the role of the grants and tax incentives for foreign direct investment. Well, this next chart maybe exaggerates and dramatizes the importance of this, but this chart shows you is the extent to which the profits of foreign-owned enterprises are important in the Irish economy. These are two different ways of measuring, and let's concentrate on that higher line. This goes from 1980, year 2000, don't have data for the earlier period, and it shows you the percentage of GDP which is contributed by the profits of foreign-owned multinationals operating in Ireland. So by 1980, the number was about 3%. That's the profit outflows, gross profit outflows. By the year 2000, it was up at 22%, I think it was, or 23%. That is the result of two factors. First, the scale of multinational corporations in Ireland. They really were employing more than half of the manufacturing workforce. They were also active in other non-manufacturing sectors. And it reflects a side effect, not such a favorable side effect, that because of the low tax rate created by government in order to induce foreign companies to come in, it was companies that were able to locate a lot of their profits in their Irish operation that came most of all. Software companies, pharmaceutical companies, companies that do a lot of research and development in California maybe, and then they set up a plant in Ireland which exploits the technology that they have developed in California and makes huge profits and pays low taxes on it. So two elements in that. Whatever you might think about the low tax regime, and I'm personally a bit dubious about the extent to which Ireland has relied for too long on such an incentive, it certainly was effective in generating considerable economic activity by multinationals. The other illustration I want to take from these five selected microeconomic policy elements that contributed to strong growth in the 1960s was secondary education. I say free secondary education. The government introduced a regime where the fees of anybody in secondary school would be paid by government. Of course, it's not free in the sense that you have an opportunity cost. You, instead of going out and getting a job as a teenager, you forego that level of income. So it's not entirely free, but free secondary education triggered an enormous expansion of the numbers of children continuing in secondary education to the age of 16 or to the age of 18. And that contributed to the human capital in the economy, which gradually, from the 1960s, the average level of education of the workforce gradually increased. And I emphasize the free secondary education, but there were also efforts to increase the availability and reduce the cost of third level education as well. So take third level. In the late 1960s, about 10% of children were going into third level. Now the number is almost 60%. And that was a gradual progression all the way up through those years. The point is that more educated workers are more productive. You're sitting here and you're becoming more educated and you will be more productive and you will benefit from it in your income, and society will benefit from your productivity as well. There are many attempts to estimate the contribution of the growing education level to Irish economic well-being and Irish economic growth in the last number of decades. There's a recent one. I just saw one of my friends and colleagues recently summarizing research. He says during the period 1990 to 2010, between a third and a half of Ireland's economic growth was attributable to the fact that in 2010, more of the workforce had a higher level of education attainment than in 1990. And this is based on econometric studies of the link between education attainment and productivity and wages. So let's look at, this is the latest data that I was able to put out. I don't know why it's not more up to date than that, but anyway, here it is. And let's look at this graph. It's a little bit complicated to think about. What are we going to learn from this graph? This is showing you age groups, 20 to 24, 25 to 34, 35 to 54, 45 to 54, 55 to 64. Seems like the statisticians don't think anybody should be working beyond the age of 64. And as a proud 67-year-old, so I'm just having leisure time here. Now, what's this showing us? The stacks are going from primary education, that's up to the age of 11 or 12. Lower second, that's if you finish before age of 15 or 16. Higher secondary, 18. The dark blue line is below degree but beyond secondary education, post leaving cert and higher certificates. The light blue is an ordinary degree, sometimes used to be called a pass degree. The orange is an honours degree, and the highest point is postgraduate. Now, what you're meant to see from that is, we'll take the oldest group. This group is in around the age of 60 in a recent time. And you can see that quite a large fraction of them, 25%, only had primary education. And quite a small fraction at the top had postgraduate qualifications. Now let's move right down then 30 years to the people who are about 30 years old in this recent period. And look, much fewer, only about 4% of them have only primary school education compared to 25% there. Far more of them have, well, certainly far more of them have lower second, upper second. You can see that every level, every higher level of education, there's a bigger bunch of them, except at the very top. And why? Well, it's at the very top, it's higher than in the around 60 years old. It's lower than the 40-year-olds because they haven't got their postgraduate qualification yet. And that's the same when you look at this one. So there's been a dramatic change in the proportions of the workforce at different age groups. And as time goes on, this group's experience will push across into here, and we'll still continue to get an increase in the average educational attainment. So there's still growth potential in that dynamic for Ireland. A few more graphs that are less complicated. This is in the last, in the early 2000s, the growth in the percentage of those that have got a third level qualification. Still growing in the 2000s. From 25% in 2000, no, 20-something percent in 2000 to 40% in 2011. And here's a cross-country comparison. It's the percentage of those, it's all the European Union countries, the percentage of those aged 25 to 34 with a third level education. The bottom of the list, Romania, then there's Italy, Austria, Malta. This is the average line. Czech Republic, Slovakia. And then towards the top, we have Denmark, Belgium, Luxembourg, Lithuania, Cyprus, and highest of all, Ireland. So a huge emphasis on education, and I think that has to be regarded as one of the main reasons why Ireland moved up in the rankings of economic welfare per person. Well, that was the 1960s, and that whole move towards education started in the 1960s. From the 1990s, a number of elements could be mentioned. Microeconomic policies that were used by government to strengthen the growth process. there was a very favorable loop, cycle between tax rate reduction and wage rate moderation in the 1990s, which was driven by social partnership. The trade unions and the employers. The employers are always delighted to have low wages. They don't, that's a constant. But the trade unions also recognized that, looking back at the experience of previous decades, they looked and realized that their members fared better when wages were set at realistic levels. Pushing wages to unaffordable levels was damaging for the workforce, damaging for union membership. And so getting an agreement on a moderate wage progression year in, year out was something that would benefit the trade union movement. And in a tripartite negotiations between the employers, the government, and the unions, the government, year after year, well, it's more or less in 3-year segments, would promise reductions in income tax. Income tax levels had reached very high rates in the 1980s. During the 1990s, government said, look, if revenue comes in the way we expect, growth continues in a healthy way, we'll be able to reduce the income tax level. Trade unions said, oh, well, if you're able to reduce the income tax, we're able to be moderate on wage demands because our after-tax wages are going to be growing. And the employers, of course, delighted with the lower wage demands, and were happy to make the investments that supported that growth. So it was a favorable dynamic of taxes and wages in that period. Let me show you there also, other good things are happening. Active labor market policies, when people were out of work, active, not just pay them an unemployment dole check every week, but engage that person in training, appropriate training, try and get them back into the labor market. Careful attention to over-regulation of, for example, air traffic. It was a very heavily regulated industry in the 1980s. Soon Ryanair arrived, and Ryanair is the biggest, I think it's the biggest airline in Europe now by the number of planes that it owns. That's a result of measured reduction in over-regulation. I won't say liberalization, because you can take that a lot too far. But just to give you, I'd like to give a quantitative example, back to the taxes and wages. You can see here, starting in 1975 and running to the more or less the end of the century, 1998, you can see that before this favorable social partnership got going in 1987, wage competitiveness for Ireland deteriorated. Going up, in this case, means deterioration. It deteriorated by about 20% from 1975 to 1987. No wonder this was a period of massive increase in unemployment and crisis. The blue line just takes dramatizes the curve by taking a mean. Subsequently, the period of social partnership and wage restraint, wage competitiveness actually improved, and the trend improved dramatically, because it was deteriorating for a while and now it was slightly improving. So this gives you a number of examples of the measures that government took which were successful and which were addressed in large part to what we could call microeconomic or structural policies. Now, what about the bad times? And let me show you that there were bad times. So this shows you two of the bad mistakes that occurred. The third one happens in the 1950s, and I thought this graph showed the 1950s, and there it is, it doesn't show the 1950s. So there's another hump there in the 1950s. It starts in 1960. There's a huge hump there in the early 1980s, and a huge hump here in the late 2000s. And these are three major macroeconomic policy errors by the Irish government. So that's back to my Aesop's fable and the Irish hare. These are the three occasions when the hare stopped dead, got distracted, tripped up, cut its knee and started to cry, whatever. One in the 1950s, one in the 1980s, and one in the 2000s. And they're good illustrations of why the government, in its attempt to use macroeconomic policy to boost the economy, but not thinking through what is feasible, what is sustainable, what is affordable. The first of these three policy errors was the interest rate blunder of 1955. Now, I thought I had a picture about this, but I don't seem to have. Let me see what happens next. Oh, yes, I do. I'll tell you about this famous interest rate blunder. It was misunderstood for years and years. In 1955, inflation was taking off in Britain, and the Bank of England decided to raise interest rates, and they raised them by 1.5 percentage points, which in those days was a lot, because interest rates were like 3%. 1.5% was a big increase in interest rates. Ireland was tied 1-for-1 with the sterling, a little bit like Barbados is tied 2-for-1 with the US dollar. So nowadays we would take it as axiomatic that, well, if the Bank of England, bigger neighbor country, same currency, raises interest rates by 1.5%, what can you do? You just have to follow suit. You have no leverage in this matter. That was not the way the Irish policymakers thought of it at the time. They thought, we have been too much under the thumb of the British. We haven't noticed any particular increase in inflation here. And we have a growth need in Ireland, and growth is going to be held back by low interest rates. So we will not increase our interest rates. And the Minister of Finance called in the banks and told them, you should not raise your interest rates. And the central bank didn't raise its interest rates either. And you can see, actually, from time to time, there had been a difference of maybe 0.5% between London and Dublin interest rates. And that's the 0.5% there that you see. Sometimes it's lower, sometimes it's higher. But look, in 1955, it zooms up to 1.5%. And that mistake, which was only sustained for about 9 months, it wasn't necessarily disastrous in itself, but it led to an outflow of funds. Companies, English companies who had affiliates in Ireland, they thought, well, if we borrowed money in Ireland, we could get it at 1.5% less, and we could use the money in England, and so on. And so there was an outflow of funds, and people panicked about the foreign exchange reserves, and they said, this is terrible. And they didn't realize that it was simply caused by the interest rate differential, and it wouldn't have happened without the interest rate differential. And the policy reaction was completely misplaced. Policy reaction was to increase tariffs, cut public spending, and there was a massive increase in unemployment and emigration in 1957. You can see that they did correct the interest rate gap. If they had just corrected the interest rate gap, that would have been enough. But they thought something deeper was wrong, and that there was a balance of payments crisis that had some deeper cause, and that they needed tariffs. Disastrous blunder. But it wasn't the only blunder that was made. 20-something years later, there was an episode of government overspending. What had happened was, we can look at the debt ratio, percentage of GNP there, 1970 to around 2002. Well, government debt was very conservative, 60% of GDP. In those days, debt wasn't as high as it is now. And debt ratios were falling until the oil crisis of 1973. And in all European countries, the response to the oil crisis was increase in government spending to balance the economy a bit better, and that was a correct response. 74, 75, 76, the crisis was of the oil crisis was more or less had settled down and things are coming back to normal. The government started in 77. You can see a slight adjustment down in the debt ratio. But in 77, there was an election and a government came in and said, we should be spending our way out of this. We've got high unemployment, we should be spending more money. If we spend more money, we can get more people to work, and more people to work will generate more productivity, and we'll get onto a favorable growth path. But they hadn't done their sums, it wasn't going to work. What did happen is a massive increase in the debt ratio to the point where international investors were losing confidence in Ireland and government wasn't really able to borrow from abroad. And so they had to squeeze much harder on the economy than they would have had to if they had just left things the way they were in 1977. There would have been a more gradual recovery of employment, but there wouldn't have been the crunch that occurred then. Let me just show you the way the debt and deficits ran there in the 1970s. You can see the pattern that I described. The deficit is the red line with the little X in it, runs from 7% of GDP right down to 14% in the middle of the oil crisis. There's some correction, but then this new government comes in and says, no, we're going to spend and spend and spend and spend and spend. And they spent until they couldn't get the money anymore. And then there's a long period of contraction. So that was the cause of the second loop, the first one in the draft, the big loop of unemployment. And the third policy error, also a macroeconomic policy error, private overborrowing in Ireland through the banking system in the period 2003 to 2007. I have a few charts on that too. Here's the Irish banks. Oh, going way back, promised a long period of history, going way back to the 1930s. This is the net foreign assets of the Irish banks. In the 1930s, you see just a few spots there. The data isn't available for all the years. And right through to the Second World War and into the early 1950s, the banks placed their excess reserves in London. They were very conservative entities, and they thought the safest place to have their money was in London. So the excess, the net external assets of the banks were large and positive, and in London. And then gradually, the banks found investment opportunities, and gradually, but in a moderate sort of way, they started to become net foreign borrowers. The series are slightly different, defined in different ways as the definitions of the collection of banks that are included changes. But you can see that right up through to the 2000, the net position is not very steep. And then in the 2000s, the Irish banks go mad and decide they're going to borrow and borrow and borrow and borrow to invest in property. And that's the cause, as that had to be unwound. That is the cause of the third jump in unemployment, the third stop of the Celtic hair. Because what was it? First banking debt became, in effect, government debt. It had a great record decline in government debt and then a record increase in government debt. And of course, it's reversed now. So I've tried to show you then in this talk the role of government can be both positive and negative. It's very important for government to put down the basics, education, social services, healthcare. It's also important for the government to create an environment which is open to enterprise, to foreign enterprise, to integrating it with the global economy, to allowing adequate flows of trade. But it's equally important for the government to stay away from over lavish and over ambitious macroeconomic policy in a small economy, because you run out of rope after a small number of years, and clambering back to where you should be is much more costly, generates a huge surge in unemployment and low economic activity. Last slide shows you the evolution. I started with population, end with population, is it shows you every 10 or 15 years from 1961 to the latest data which just was published, shows you the people who live in the Republic of Ireland, what did they do in terms of employment? Well, first of all, there are a lot more of them than there were in 1961. 1961 is actually the date at which the Irish population was at its lowest ever on record, certainly its lowest since sometime in the middle of the 18th century. Gradual increase, jump to 1986, bit of stagnation, and a rapid increase in the 2000s. And by the end, the population of Ireland has grown by over 50% from 1961. That's due to natural increase. It's due to return of migrants that left in the 1950s or in the 1970s, came back again. And it's due to net immigration from other parts of the world, Eastern Europe, West Africa, Nigeria, China. And what are they doing? Well, some of them are children under 15. You see, about the same proportion in 2016 as there were in 1961. And then there are old timers. There's more of them because everybody's getting older. And then the yellow part is inactive. So that could be students. Are you inactive?
Yes, we're all inactive.
But look, and then you have the unemployed in the bad times, in the 1980s. It's quite a fat, light blue bar there for the unemployed. Very small bar in the 2001. Larger bar in 2016, unemployment 6.5%, still recovering from the bust. And then you have people working in agriculture, less productive part of the economy. There were a lot in 1961 still, the purple line, and very few now. And the huge increase in the number of at work outside of agriculture. The increase is much bigger than the growth in population as a whole. Why? Because more women are working. That's basically the reason. And so much greater participation in the productive economy. So if you look at the statistics on Ireland, and some of them look as if Ireland is one of the most prosperous countries on earth, which isn't really, because built into a lot of those statistics are those multinational profits that I showed you earlier on. And so they don't do any good to Ireland, they're just shipped back to the United States. But a lot of it is due to the greater number of people at work, because when the economy is close to full employment, and the fact that they are more productive because they are supported by an educational system and other social systems that allow them to be productive and engaged in the global economy. So that's what I wanted to say, and I'd like to be there to answer questions.
Thank you, Dr. Patrick Honohan. We're now open for questions. Before you say what your question is, kindly indicate who you are and briefly say what program you're in. Thank you. Since I'm the host, I have the first question. Dr. Honohan, I'm very pleased with your emphasis on the movement in terms of population growth and the emphasis on human capital. One of the things that strike me about your delivery is that you focus on economic empowerment, empowering individuals in that they know that their decision would impact on their economic status and that of the country itself. So my question to you is, how important do you see the role of creativity in this drive that government has to increase the knowledge warehouse, increase the higher attainment of education? So how do you see the role of vocational training so students become more creative, so that reduces the burden on government? Thank you.
I think creativity, it enters in a number of different ways. First of all, there are the creative industries, so-called creative industries themselves, and we see a lot of Irish successes, U2 and popular music, drama, theatre and that. But much more deeply, I think the modern economy with availability of information technology allows enterprise and innovation and creativity to work at all levels. So if you, in the old days, if you're working in a factory, a sugar factory, let's say, well, the best thing is to make sure that the sugar factory, the machinery is well oiled in the way you have been told to do it, and you probably will not be able to find a better way to oil it than the way you've been told to oil it. But if your machinery is a piece of software, you don't have to be the managing director to see, hey, we could put in a little fix into this software and it could work better and we could deliver a better outcome for us. And I think that's where education, of a general education, so you your problem solving in the university, in the secondary school, in the university, your problem solving in one area, you become good at problem solving. You find that problems can be solved and that a little bit of thought helps you have a more productive and a more enjoyable work experience, and you can transfer that so that even if in class what you're being taught is not actually being used in the workplace, what you have learnt in terms of as you use your word, creativity, but flexibility can be transferred. And I actually think this is one of the, I'm an economist, not a sociologist, but I do think it's one of the elements that allowed Ireland to benefit from the IT revolution and move up the value chain in the 1990s. It's hard to pin it down, but I think that particularly the crises have silver linings. The crisis of the 1980s, so many people out of work, kids come out of school, said, or university, said, well, what job? What's the job? The old jobs aren't there anymore. Oh, somebody is doing something, I'll help them. And they were in a more fluid environment. Computers had started at that time, and using in a fluid environment, the availability of software and enough educational background was the magic that turned a lot of, opened a lot of doors. Who's going to ask the next question?
Thank you very much, Dr. Honohan. My name is Noveline Brewster. I'm from the Central Bank of Barbados. Interesting presentation. I'm not an economist by training. I don't even understand much about economics, but I like the subject area. Am I correct in deducing from your presentation that perhaps government's role in sustainable economic development, growth and development, is perhaps focusing on human capital development? Is that a correct assumption? And the second question, that you focused on free secondary education being available in Ireland, but what about tertiary education? What is government's role in providing or assisting in the area of tertiary education?
Yeah, well, I have emphasized human capital. I think it's very, very important, but I also think that some of the other elements, openness to international trade, the social safety net, because if we don't have a society that catches people when they fall and that has a sufficient degree of equality, so there are a number of things, but the human capital is very important. The free education was a transformative thing. Should education be free is a different question. Ensuring that education reaches all those who can benefit from it, I think, is the goal. The mechanism is different. I do think free secondary education is having that as an available thing is nearly all advanced economies start to build that in. Much more controversial, tertiary education, and you see flip-flops in different countries. Ireland did actually introduce free university education in the late 1990s, but it has been eroded since. The universities don't like it. They feel they lose their autonomy. They say, well, the students want this, and the Department of Education says, the students may want it, but we are paying. So we are going to decide what's going to happen. So there are complexities in the decision of how to engineer that improvement in human capital. But of course, there have to be, since you want education to reach all social classes, there have to be subsidies built in, because otherwise children from poor backgrounds will not have access to the education that they can benefit from. So just how to engineer that, what's the best structure of incentives is a different question, a more complicated question. Next one.
Good morning. My name is Shafa McDowell. I'm an econ student. You mentioned that women joining the workforce would have it would have added to the economic output. But now in the Caribbean, we're seeing less and less males proportionally joining the education force, like less males are taking part in tertiary education. How do you think that would affect us in the long run?
I think the dramatic success of women in education over the last 30 or 40 years, it's right across many, many countries. And used to be the boys always got the top places, and then, oh, there's this bright girl and managed to do reasonably well. But now it's not like that at all. You see, people worrying year on year. It's not just Caribbean. People worrying year on year. Why is the educational attainment and the achievement in terms of grades and so forth, why are the men falling behind? So that's a deep question, and it's not something that I think I have a ready answer to. I think if you had a society where all the men sat at home and the women were working, I think that would be probably worse than the old society where the men were working and the women, well, they weren't sitting at home, because what happens when the women come home after the work and the men have been sitting there all day, the women end up doing the work that they used to do anyway when they weren't working. There's a great cartoon which summarizes this. It has two panels, top and the bottom. The top one, it's obviously her birthday, his birthday. The first one, it's his birthday. They're getting up. He says, "Stay in bed." He goes downstairs, and the kettle is boiling, and he's sitting waiting for the kettle to boil. He's watching the kettle boiling, and then the third thing is he's serving her breakfast in bed for, you know, her birthday or something. And the lower panel, obviously, it's his birthday, and she says, "Stay in bed." And the next thing is the kettle is boiling, but what she's doing, she has a big bundle of washing, and she's doing this and doing that, and you know. Okay. That's what sociologists study. It's not appropriate to micro level to microeconomics. Yeah.
Javon Lewis, double major in economics and management. My question is that from your presentation, you said that the agriculture sector was not really productive compared to other sectors of the economy. With the Caribbean countries coming out from benefiting from, let's say, Barbados with sugarcane, St. Lucia with bananas, mainly the agricultural sectors, which other sectors can the governments focus on, probably giving tax incentives in order to boost the economic well-being of the countries?
Obviously, as the proportion of the population working in agriculture shrinks and shrinks and shrinks, the remaining people are, the reason it's shrinking is because they are becoming more and more productive. So, you know, in Western European societies, it is not the case that agriculture is as far behind the average of the economy as it was 50 years ago. What are the industries that are going to be successful? You know, this can be a huge mistake to get to say, well, I think we should have a committee that will go and study this and decide, because I think in the fluid world that we've been living in for the last 50 years, it is hard to predict in detail which industries, which products will be successful. And the only way to make progress is to create the environment in which enterprise can flourish, foreign enterprise can flourish. And that's why the importance of education, because it's general. Because if you spend your money on education instead of spending it on subsidizing a particular sector which you think is going to be great, then when a strong industry comes in, you have the workforce for it. That's not to say that there haven't been successes. There have been successes in a number of countries that have pushed particular sectors, as examples from Korea and examples from Japan. There are also failures in Korea and Japan. Basically, it's hard for outsiders to know. If you're not involved in industry and enterprise, you aren't tracking these developments sufficiently closely to offer opinions on that.
So, Winston Moore, BSc Economics Special. So you showed a really interesting chart on the national debt, where the debt rose to around 140% of GDP. And one of the things that is always discussed is whether or not there is an ideal or optimal level of national debt. Because when debt is too low, you can't invest in, say, education and public infrastructure. And if it's too high, then the interest expense and the amortization then puts a burden on the government. So what about that idea of an optimal level of debt? Do you think we should have a rule saying that debt should not go above a particular level? Or
There was a very famous paper published about 10 years ago by Reinhardt and Rogoff, who claimed that they had found a magic number. Yeah. I think the magic number was 95%. Was it 95%? No, 60% was one. This is the one I'm talking about now, is not the 60% paper that you're talking about, but the I'm talking about a 95% one, where they said that in the experience of countries' growth was that growth was lower for countries that had a debt ratio higher than 95%. And why would that be? And I think you put your finger on the probably the most important factor is that interest rates start to, not only are you paying the interest on a higher amount, but you're probably going to pay a lot more interest because in the financial markets are going to say, well, these fellas are 110% debt. Am I actually going to be paid back? Probably am, but I'd like to get a bit more interest on the way before things go badly wrong. The other dimension is that your room for maneuver is very limited. So there's some adverse shock, a hurricane or a global downturn, and you're already at 110% of GDP, and you're getting to the point where you say, well, we need to borrow to fill the hole created by the hurricane or to create the hole created by the downturn in exports. And you just can't, because the foreign markets won't lend to you, because probably those are the circumstances that make them additionally worried. So those seem to be the factors that you would expect, but is a 95% a magic number? And there was a very heated debate in the last number of years, and then some fellas, so it was a woman in Yale and a colleague, they found a mistake in the paper, the Reinhardt Rogoff paper. They found a mistake. Actually, you know, so probably, no, this is not going to work. Maybe this one. No, there you go.
I don't think those work.
They don't work. There was still, thank you very much. So if you had the growth rate, if this is the growth rate here, and this is the debt to GDP ratio, and they had measured this curve, which said that something like that this, and then it sort of went down at 95%. And the revised paper said, no, this number is wrong here, and this one, that's wrong, and you made several mistakes. And the enemies of this paper said, that's it, there's no magic number. But actually, if you redid the numbers, and they did redid the people from Yale, it's still a downward slope, it's just not as steep, and it doesn't have a kink at 95. So there's still a problem with very high debt ratios, and it is, as you say, the practical one. You're paying more interest, and you're paying it on more debt, and you don't have any room for maneuver. So Italy has 130% of GDP debt, and they're squeezing all the time because they can't. So I don't know what the magic number is. There's another magic number, which is 60%, which Professor Moore was mentioning as well. This is 60% is very prudent. You're going to be very safe at 60%. And the 60% came from an idea that interest rates and growth rates would give you a configuration that 60% would be a nice, steady equilibrium. But nobody thinks 60% is a secure number, and most people think you can get by on higher debt ratios. But debt runs up very quickly. So you see, we need to borrow a bit more in order to pay for the infrastructure and so forth. That's fine. But if you're paying it year after year after year, it'll grow very quickly.
Good day, Dr. Honohan. In your presentation, you'd have mentioned, Ian Constantine, Economics and Law. Within your presentation, you made a focus on educational attainment and aiding in growth, all right? Here, if in our university system, what you would see is that our Pro Vice Chancellor has continually mentioned that in order to ensure viability as a university, we need continued financing investment. What we've noticed in our region particularly, some of the governments have been defaulting on their payments, all right? Even local government to an extent. So what I would like to find out is what steps can they take to help, aid along the process and reduce that debt? And what steps should they take to repay the university in a timely manner?
So over indebtedness is always a big problem, and we talked about that there on the last occasion. The normal way to reduce over indebtedness, and it's a good household financial advice, is to try and increase your income and try and reduce your expenditure. And it's as simple as that. As you say, a couple of countries in the region, smaller countries mainly, have got into default situations. That undermines a lot of things. It's a sort of on-off situation. It's not like, let's default a little bit. You either default or you don't default. If you default, I'm never going to lend to that country. And people do lend to those countries again. They sort of come back, and the interest rates are higher. But it undermines confidence in business activities as well. They say, wait a minute, if they default on that, I'm promised that, well, maybe they won't keep that promise either. So we're always very cautious about talking about default. It's not an easy option. A number of countries have defaulted. Countries that default once have often defaulted multiple times. They get a reputation. Greece, Argentina, over the years, over 100 years, Argentina is constantly defaulting. So it's no wonder they can't borrow very much money and their financial system is very small. Now it can be, countries can get into a situation where this is the best way forward. Usually because it's a mistake has happened. The debt has accumulated in a way that wasn't foreseen, wasn't understood at the time. Case of Greece, 2009, they said, well, I'm sorry, we were lying. Our deficit is much higher and our debt is much higher. Whoa, so now you have an unsustainable debt. Well, because normally the brakes come on before, the financial markets, the interest rates have gone up before you get to a situation that's so acute that you need to default. So default's not an easy option. How will the university get paid? That's a matter of politics. It's a matter of the government to decide. It needs to decide what to spend money on, year in, year out. It's a big topic of fiscal design. It's politics. It's also economics, as we see. If certain types of expenditure are going to boost growth over 10, 20, 30, 40 years, you say, well, let's not pull back on those just because there's some immediate issue that would seem politically attractive in the short run. That's a whole other lecture, though. So we have time for a couple more questions. One more question.
Okay, I will go.
It's all right.
Good morning, Doctor. My name is Joshua Cox. I do economics for my major. My question is, from your presentation, I have seen a lot of causes for or stimulations of economic growth within Ireland, right? And based on observation, I have seen that the Caribbean has done a lot of things. A lot of the things which have been seen in the presentation, for example, promotion of education, for example, in Trinidad and Barbados, education up to tertiary level for a long time was free and stuff. However, I don't feel as though that the Caribbean has been benefiting like these other countries. So my question to you is, where have we gone wrong? Or what can we do to reach that level that Ireland has reached to?
In fact, where I started was really at the beginning of the talk, was to show you how bad those first 50 years were in Ireland. So it takes a long time to build institutions in an independent state, politics in an independent state government, and start gradually to get more and more benefits from a well-functioning set of political and economic institutions in society. So you're only halfway through. The Caribbean, most of the Caribbean islands independent in the 1960s, sometimes 70s, only halfway through that first 100 years. The best is still to come. Shall we leave it at that?
Jade Clawson is now going to give a vote of thanks.
Invited guests, fellow students, ladies and gentlemen, it is my esteemed pleasure to say thank you on behalf of the students in Econ 2001, our lecturer, Dr. Anki Scott-Joseph, and the Department of Economics. Dr. Honohan, today we have heard the debate between those who see the government as the best main driver of economic development and those who think that the private sector should be freed from government interference. Based on the experience of the past few decades, you have argued that both extremes have been mistaken, and instead, economic development success is most likely when political consensus supports a strong role for government, but one which gives ample room also for private initiative. Your comments are very timely as we usher in a new phase in the economics of development, with dark clouds and a few silver linings. As aspiring economists, we are cognizant of the challenges that lie ahead and the possible solutions. Thank you for your contribution and for the very interesting, thought-provoking lecture. Sincere gratitude is extended to the Central Bank of Barbados, its technical team and its representatives, Noveline Brewster, Dale Christie Bourne, Sherry Bishop, Matthew Rawlings, for co-facilitating today's session and for providing us with the opportunity to hear from Dr. Honohan and to draw from his expertise. To you, the audience, and my fellow undergraduates, thank you for participating and supporting this event.
Dr. Patrick Honohan, on behalf of my classmates of Econ 2001, Intermediate Microeconomics 2, class of 2017, please accept our sincere appreciation for your invaluable contribution to the discussion, public sector and economic development. We greatly appreciate and thank you for taking time out of your busy schedule to speak with the undergraduates here at the University of the West Indies Cable Campus, Barbados. Thank you so very much. Right, so this is a certificate signed by all the students from the lecture.
Dr. Honohan, this certificate has been personalized by each student of this class, Intermediate Micro. This not only shows our individual gratitude, but it also shows that we are very thankful for you to be here. So thank you very much.
Nowhere for your microphone.
Thank you. You want to respond?
I think this is. I really appreciate this. I mean, it shows how involved you guys are in your studies, and I, you know, wish you all the best in continuing your degree course and maybe going on to postgraduate and contributing to productivity and growth in Barbados in the years ahead. And in maybe other regional countries that some of you come from, not just Barbados.
Our students are going to be awarded for very good different aspects. The first we're going to start with is we would have had a group present speak. The members of this group is Rhea Connell. Please come forward. Rohan Foster, Ricardo Luke, Jabari Jones, Victoria Marshall, Nicholas Nisblett, and Rashida Rawlings. Okay, among that group, there was one young lady, part of the course, really fits with the agricultural sector, and she did a wonderful job in delivering that project, and her name is Rashida Rawlings. Please come and accept. Okay, the other awards are given to students who did well in other aspects. Now, to the best presenter, and you will all agree with me, his name is Javon Lewis. There are three of them. They were actually competing. The first, Melissa Griffith. Ian Constantine for being the most disciplined student. And Jade Curtin for being the most outstanding student. Now, Jade has been very involved in each aspect of the course, not only tutorials, but also during the lecture sessions and other aspects. So Jade, we do encourage you. Lastly, for the student who has done the best in each aspect, an average of 95% for his coursework. Okay, thank you very much. One moment, please.
Just thanks a lot. And maybe do some presentations as well in my class. So this is a really excellent job. And to you guys that have received the awards, continue.